not the time to shirk.
Welcome to We Can Do It, a Canadian podcast focused on climate change, the environment, and nuclear energy. Welcome back to the podcast. Today I'm joined by Mike Rencheck, the president and CEO of Bruce Power, which is Canada's largest nuclear power generating station, and I believe until recently was one of the largest nuclear generating stations in the world. Mike, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks, and it still is. It's great to be here, Chris. I look forward to today's discussion.
For sure. So just to clarify, is it the biggest?
We're still the largest operating nuclear station in the world. Others are continuing to build out, and someday it will be surpassed, but we are the largest right now.
That's wild. I think most Ontarians have no idea about that. We'll dive into that in a bit more depth and hopefully get people up to current on what's going on at Bruce and in the field more generally. So, you know, Mike, we're talking a couple days before Earth Day here. We're releasing this on Earth Day. But I think it's interesting to note that there's kind of competing versions of what a green future looks like. Something that's on my table right now is a new film that's coming out called Bright Green Lies. And it's sort of, I think, following up on this movie that Michael Moore produced called Planet of the Humans. And it's kind of a critique of renewable energy's environmental impact, which I think people are becoming increasingly aware of and uncomfortable with. But, you know, in both of these films, it seems like the thesis is, well, you know, energy is just bad in general. And they don't really lay out an alternative other than something that's probably kind of disastrous and Malthusian, because energy is so vital. And I mean, as an example of that, and this is very timely that we're having this discussion today, because my hospital's just had a major power outage and we're barely scraping by on diesel generation right now. So, you know, as a podcast, which, you know, the byline is, you know, it's a podcast with an I have a dream attitude towards climate, environment, and energy. I'm looking forward to looking at alternatives of what a green future can look like and alternative energy sources that can both allow the environment as well as humanity to flourish. So with all that in mind, Mike, tell us a bit about yourself and why and how you became involved in nuclear energy.
Yeah, sure. First, my name is Mike Rencheck. I'm president and CEO of Bruce Power. And I got involved in nuclear energy in 1982 when I graduated from university. And I started my career right outside of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, at Shippingport, Pennsylvania, where the first commercial nuclear reactor was constructed years ago. And I got into nuclear power in an era when, you know, my father's industry was still making and it was closing down. So it really provided an economic opportunity for myself and my family, and really has been a great look at the way we generate energy and generate energy cleanly. So I look forward to today's discussion. Clearly you got a lot of background in this, but I've worked in other, predominantly the utility business for now about 40 years. And I've worked on fossil fuels, wind, hydro, solar, on and on and on. So I've got a pretty good background, including carbon capture and sequestration systems and all kinds of things, early days of batteries and the like. So my love brought me back to nuclear some years ago, and here I am at Bruce Power, and we're powering the future here with a clean energy future.
All right, Mike. So, I mean, I think, you know, a lot of folks in Ontario, they're not really aware that we are primarily powered by nuclear energy. I kind of feel, you know, as I've become more educated on the topic, that nuclear has been this kind of elephant in the room that, you know, kind of hums away quietly in the background and that people don't really talk about. And I think it's very interesting, again, that, you know, we have, you know, and I've participated in things like climate marches, but people don't realize that, at least as far as electricity is concerned, we're leading the world. You know, there's this great app called Electricity Map where you can check kind of hour to hour generation and what sources are providing and what the carbon intensity of our electricity is. And Ontario is routinely in the top 10 in that regard in terms of lowest emissions grids. It wasn't always that way. We were 25% coal powered up until I think around 2013 or so. And I understand Bruce had a pretty big role in kicking coal off the grid. Can you, let's dive into that a little bit.
Yeah, sure. You know, when you look at Bruce Power, some decades ago, the Bruce A units were shut down in the 90s, pending a refurbishment, and the Bruce B units can continue to run. So we have four units at Bruce A and four units at Bruce B. And at that time, we were rated at about 6,300 megawatts total. So quite a large capacity. The Bruce A units were restarted in the early 2000s and then mid 2000s. And with the unit one and two coming back online, we were able to phase out coal here in Ontario. So when the Bruce units came online, we supplied about 70% of the energy necessary to phase out coal generation. With that, we saw a reduction from a peak of about 53 smog days a summer, say in 2005, 2006 timeframe. To today, it's zero. In the last 4 or 5 years, it's been zero. We might have an hour here or there of an exceedance, but no more. So if you have asthma and you go outside now, you can breathe instead of worrying whether you can go outside and really have a medical emergency at the end of the day.
Yeah, I mean, I'm very familiar with those medical emergencies. I've been in practice for just about 10 years now. So that takes me back to a time when there was still a lot of coal in the grid. I went to medical school in Hamilton, and we also had a more active steel industry at that time. But I remember kind of scraping particulate off of my windowsills on a pretty regular basis. And certainly anecdotally, I've seen a big drop in severe respiratory illnesses. We know air pollution is, you know, attacks organ systems beyond the lungs and is responsible for a significant burden of disease from heart attacks and strokes and cancers and things like that. So, you know, but it's a really kind of well-kept secret, it seems. I was researching this topic a little bit because, again, this was fascinating to me that, you know, we're a world leader in terms of our electricity grid. We're a model for the world. This phase out was called, I think, by the Ontario Power Authority, the biggest greenhouse gas reductions in North America. But, you know, when I was researching it, I found your guys' report with the Asthma Society of Canada. But on the official government reports, nuclear is barely mentioned or, you know, those figures are not quoted. I have a friend who updated the Wikipedia article about it and, you know, used some of the background primary data. But anyway, it's interesting. I mean, do you feel like there's an issue in terms of either the industry communicating these benefits or else, you know, the media not sufficiently covering this topic? Because, I mean, this is highly relevant to me.
Yeah, you know, we talk about it every chance we get because I think people need to know the facts and really know the story. The heavy lifting has been done by nuclear for decades around the world in terms of clean energy. When we look here in Ontario, because of nuclear and hydro, which nuclear is 60% of the supply and hydro is about 25% of the supply, followed by renewable energies about 8%. We have one of the cleanest grids in the world for as far as emissions go, and that's also carbon dioxide emissions. You know, if you believe in deep decarbonization, the electric sector is looked at in terms of deep decarbonization having a footprint of less than 50 grams equivalent of carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour. Well, here in Ontario, we're about 35 grams, mm-hmm. and that heavy lifting is done by nuclear and hydro. And we see that throughout the world. You'll see similar profiles in France and in Sweden, also economies that have very low profile for carbon emissions and emissions in general. But, you know, often the world looks towards Germany or California as leading, and Germany is about 500 grams equivalent of CO2 per kilowatt hour with many more billions and billions of dollars to invest. And California is sitting at about 135 grams equivalent of CO2 per kilowatt hour and still, you know, billions to invest. In fact, they're shutting down one of their lone remaining nuclear plants, so they'll have to replace that capacity on top of other clean energy they're going to have to add. So you can imagine how expensive this is going to get. And the reason why I say that, here in Ontario, our electricity is about 13.5 cents on average. If you live in Germany, you're paying about 30 cents Canadian. And California, similar, and there's still billions of investment to do there. Here in Ontario, we already have effectively a CO2-free grid, and we should be using that for economic development in the area. Any company that locates here to Ontario and plugs anywhere into the electric grid is effectively getting CO2-free energy. So you don't have to do any greenwashing. It really is an economic, you know, it should be used for economic advocacy. Our clean energy sources here. So all of our homeowners, if you're using electricity, you're getting CO2 free energy across your grid, and you need to feel good about that. You've invested in it, you've paid for it, and it's there. Our clean energy is reliable baseload energy coming from nuclear power and hydro, so we're not dependent on the weather. We can get through severe weather events, just like we saw in Texas in the winter with the crash of their grid, and then California last summer with the rolling blackouts. We don't have that here in Ontario, and we enjoy a robust supply of electricity that's clean and emissions free.
It's interesting you say that. I know Iceland has become a bit of a site for, you know, a lot of kind of server farms and high energy using companies to go to. I think partially because they can advertise that their, you know, electricity is essentially carbon free. And I mean, in Iceland, they have copious amounts of hydro as well as some geothermal resources. But you don't hear that about Ontario. I had Paul Accioni on, who's the former Ontario Society of Professional Engineers president. And he was saying that there's even more opportunities because we do, you know, produce sometimes a surplus of clean energy, particularly at off-demand times. And so we could be doing combination water heaters, for instance, some combination heating, where you were kind of using some smart grid ideas to use that carbon-free surplus energy to, you know, to decarbonize other sectors. So I think there's room to even kind of improve further, which I think is really interesting. So we've kind of touched on the coal phase out a little bit. I want to move a bit into talking about the future. You know, we are in the midst of this horrible pandemic right now. And, you know, as I was mentioning, my hospital right now is having a major power outage, and that's not due to the grid. I think it's something internal with the hookup. But I mean, it does point to how essential energy is in our lives. And I think, you know, that earlier point I was making about some elements of the environmental movement waking up to the enormous environmental impacts of, you know, renewable energy, the mining impacts, and just the fact that windmills and solar turbines aren't just created out of, you know, magical materials, but just like everything else, have to be mined and processed. You know, I think it's interesting just how essential electricity and energy is. So in that context, I was interested to hear from talking to some folks at Bruce that, you know, your workers have not yet been sort of prioritized in terms of vaccination. You know, when we think about frontline workers and sort of heroes of this pandemic, to me, it's, you know, especially in a world where, look, we're using Zoom right now, we're so dependent on electricity. Can you give us any update on what's going on there, on, you know, if you're making progress on that? Because I'd sure like you guys to get vaccinated quickly.
Yeah, thanks. You know, we have fantastic people that work here. They work hard. They come in every day. We have a number of things that we're doing, not only to supply clean energy to the province, but we also generate medical isotopes that are used to sterilize about 40% of the once-used medical devices around the world. So if you're in a doctor's or dentist's office or a hospital anywhere in the world, there's a 40% chance that an isotope made here in Tiverton, Ontario, sterilized the equipment that's being used. And I think that obligation our people take very seriously. And they've come to work every day. We implement very strong protocols here for maintaining a safe and healthy work environment. And we've done quite well. In fact, we have probably one of the premier on-site testing programs in the country, if not the world. Since October, we've done about 76,000 tests here at site. And really, since the beginning of the year, we've probably done over half of that to really ensure that we have a safe workplace. And we've been working steadily with public health to make sure that our people are recognized for their performance. We expect to be in the second wave with the vaccinations. And hopefully we continue to get more vaccinations here in the province, and we can roll it out faster. So we're excited about that. And we, you know, we've been instrumental in working with public health, not only in our area, but throughout the area. We've innovated and came up with mass vaccination centers called hockey hubs, where we can do up to 3,500 people a day. In fact, I saw an article issued by Grey Goose Health the other day. They set a record for 350 vaccinations an hour. Wow. Going through one of the hockey hubs in Hanover. So, you know, we have the capability to plan these things. We're good at logistics. We have that safety perspective in mind all the time. So we think we're a good match with public health when it comes to being able to do these things. So again, thanks for asking that. And we're open to be in the second wave, and we're working with public health to get, to get vaccines here once they're available.
You know, just on the topic of the workforce, I think this is a really important topic because, obviously there's an economic devastation as a result of, the lockdowns, which have been necessary to control the spread of this pandemic. And also within the context of climate change, and we're talking about a transition away from fossil fuels, there's a real concern about, there's a lot of good jobs in that sector, and how do we have this just transition? And, when you talk about nuclear, it seems like, well, here's this clean energy source, and, there's a lot of high quality jobs here in Canada that perhaps provide that model for what a clean energy transition can look like. Can you talk a little bit more about, how many people are working at Bruce or in the sector in general?
Yeah, quite frankly, we're hiring. So when you look at the nuclear energy sector here in Ontario, between Ontario Power Generation and Bruce Power, we'll be investing close to $26 billion in the renewal of our assets. Here at Bruce Power, we're investing close to $13 billion. We'll be creating 22,000 direct and indirect jobs as it relates to our efforts. That's almost 500 primary suppliers that deal directly with us. And then each of those suppliers have a continuation where they're dealing with other suppliers. For example, we have one $30 million order with an automation company in the area, and they have contracts with 100 other companies supplying them parts to build robots for us. Wow. Right, so that economic footprint is alive and well, and we were able to manage successfully throughout the pandemic to keep our supply chain functional. See, it's a big focus of ours here at Bruce Power is to also look after our communities and look after our partners. When we were able to implement COVID protocols here and we knew they would work, we simply rolled them out to our suppliers. Many of our big suppliers took our protocols verbatim and implemented them at their factories, and they've been able to keep working all throughout this pandemic as we have here at the site. And when you think about that, right, a job has been hard to come by this last year, not only a job, but a good paying job, and the expansion and the hiring has continued. So right now on any given day, we have about 3,500 people reporting to site. Normally, if it was outside the pandemic, we'd probably be close to 6,500. And then all told, there's probably 11,000 people that have access to the site coming in and out to do different engineering work, trades work, supply components, supply parts. So we are impacting Ontario's economy throughout the province, adding about $3 to $4 billion in GDP each year, about $8 to $11 billion in GDP for Canada total. And then here locally, we're in rural Ontario. So Finding a facility like this that can have that kind of employment, we've set up some economic development outreach for Grey Bruce and Huron counties. Since we started in 2016, we've seen about 63 companies relocate into our area now to set up shop to be able to support our efforts. So we've seen probably 250,000-300,000 square feet of abandoned buildings, old factories that had been shut down for decades or burned out, now renovated and put in use to do light manufacturing. We've seen the creation of new businesses. Even throughout the pandemic, we continue to see creation of small businesses in the area, and we see a growing population. So, we've had a big input here in rural Ontario, and our life extension program started in 2016, and it'll carry on all the way through 2033. So we think we can actually change the economic prosperity for our region, for the province over that time frame, while continuing to produce clean energy and medical isotopes. So we're very bullish on the types of things we've been able to do, not only for Bruce Power, for Bruce Power's employees, but our communities and the people in general that live throughout the province.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really interesting point that nuclear tends to really support the local economy. And I mean, particularly in Canada, where, we have been an absolute leader. We created our own design, which, met some of the unique challenges we had, not using uranium enrichment, and not requiring a heavy foraging industry. So, you know, I was reading an OPG report and they were saying 95% of the, you know, money invested into the refurbishments is staying, I think, even in Ontario, but certainly within Canada. And then the other person I was talking to was Bob Walker, who's one of the union leaders. And he was saying, you know, he gave me this parking lot metaphor because, you know, all energy sources are not created equal in terms of the job creation potential. And, you know, so if you go to a solar farm, there's really not a parking lot, or a wind farm. You know, gas plants can operate with a real skeleton crew, but, you know, the parking lots at, you know, Pickering, Darlington and Bruce are quite large. A lot of people work there. So that was just kind of an interesting illustration. So yeah, I mean, I think you've probably already covered this in enough detail, and we'll kind of move on to the some of the environmental stuff. But if you got something to add, go ahead.
Yeah, I would. I'd like to add, you know, when we talk about that investment, we are a made in Ontario solution. 90% of the money that we spend stays in Ontario, and 98% of it stays in Canada. Wow. So we are a native industry. We work to really for the people of Canada and the people of Ontario. And we're stimulating the economy, like I said, all throughout the province and really throughout Canada.
And, you know, it's also, I mean, the other thing I've been thinking about is just how, you know, this sector is probably one of the only remaining sectors that provides that kind of intergenerational secure employment. I mean, with the sort of flight of our manufacturing base, you know, in auto manufacturing and in steel, those kind of jobs just don't seem to exist anymore. And I think we've, you know, I like I said, I did my medical training in Hamilton, and that was a city that was just devastated by the economic blow of Stelco, you know, largely shutting down. And I saw that every day in sort of these personal tragedies of drug addiction and of everyday poverty. You know, people that used to have dignified, well-paying, you know, blue collar jobs. And, you know, now we're largely on social assistance, and, you know, it's rough. Like, on the medical side, you really, you know, and especially in emergency medicine, like I would talk to these people, you know, share some very intimate moments of vulnerability with them, support them through some of what they're going through. But fundamentally, I mean, in medicine, we talk a lot about social determinants of health. It's a lot of this upstream stuff. So, you know, when I hear that nuclear is, you know, too expensive, I think the counter is that the money stays here and stimulates our economy. And, you know, That's been sort of my recent take on this anyway.
Yeah, let me talk about nuclear being too expensive. So the Ontario Energy Board provides that pricing year in and year out on what energy sources cost. So when you look at the supply mix in Ontario and look at how much they cost, as an example, Bruce Power were about 7.8 cents per kilowatt hour. So you know, you have Ontario Power Generation about 8.9 cents kilowatt hour, so a little bit more. But then you're sitting there with wind at about 14.8 cents kilowatt hour, gas is about 14.3 cents a kilowatt hour, and solar is at about 49 cents a kilowatt hour. So that's published annually. So we here in nuclear are the low cost producer, along with hydro, which is about 6.5 cents per kilowatt hour. So hydro and nuclear keep the price of power low in Ontario. And really keep the grid supplied here in Ontario. So we are carrying the heavy and doing the heavy lifting for the province and keeping prices down. That's why, you know, when you look at our grid being so green and CO2 free and at about 13.5 cents per kilowatt hour on average, you compare that to California, which is predominantly renewables at about 30 cents in Germany, still has a great mix of wind and coal-fired generation at about 30 cents. You know, we're well ahead of the pack here in terms of both keeping electricity prices in check as well as keeping our environmental footprint low. So I think when you look at nuclear, without nuclear in this mix, prices would be moving more towards what we see in California and Germany.
Yeah, I mean, from what I understand, I mean, we're going to be losing a good chunk of our nuclear, I think about 20% of our generation when Pickering closes in 2025. And it looks like a lot of that's going to be replaced by gas, which is a real kind of tragedy to be working, you know, in the wrong direction on this, especially in the context of this climate crisis. You know, you're mentioning those, the economics and the cost of each source. And I'm not sure again, how this carbon tax is going to play out, but you could imagine if, you know, if we're at $50 a ton, that gas could get quite expensive, in relation to other sources. So it's, you know, it's interesting. We made a choice, with the Green Energy Act to, you know, invest heavily in renewables. And I think the tally is around 40 or 50 billion. And it's just, It's interesting. I mean, what do you, I know OPG is talking about, you know, some new builds at Darlington. I'm very curious because I heard that at some point in the early 2000s, Bruce had a plan to try and do an expansion into Alberta. And, you know, we were talking earlier about, you know, Ontario being a leading clean energy grid. I mean, some of our provinces are also amazing because they have, you know, incredible hydro resources. So BC, Manitoba, Quebec, they do very well, but we have, you know, Ontario has some run of the river hydro, but not certainly not those kind of resources. And when we're looking at high emitting provinces like Nova Scotia or Alberta or Saskatchewan, I mean, for me, it seems like Ontario could really be that model, you know, on a nationwide level. I don't know if you can provide any details about kind of what happened in Alberta, if there's any chance for future expansion to kind of make up for what we're losing in Ontario, but if you do, I'd love to hear about it.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So first of all, like, we have great assets here in Ontario with our plants. Like, when we started our process here of life extension, our plant was rated at about 6,300 megawatts total. Somewhere just in 2017.
For our listeners that aren't familiar with those numbers, because they're big numbers, what does that translate into in terms of households powered, or I don't know, percent of the grid? Like, it's we have the largest nuclear plant in the world. What does that translate into?
So we power about 31% of the grid.
Okay.
Today, so 31% of all of Ontario's power comes from Bruce Power here in Tiverton. And so somewhere around 2017, we increased our output by 100 megawatts, so the 6,400 megawatts. And we're continuing to do that. So we have plans that, with the right work that's ongoing, we'll have some announcement this summer that you'll see our power get upgraded again. And then throughout the decade, we believe with the great engineering work and innovation that we have going on with our engineering teams, we have the possibility of going well over 7,000 megawatts here at the site. So effectively having added an entire reactor virtually by better improvements, by better technologies, more modern technologies, more efficient equipment as we're doing our life extension program. It also comes down to the energy that comes out. You know, historically, our units ran at about 83% capacity factor in total. Well, as we renew these units, we're working to push that capacity factor well up into the mid 90s. So we'll be providing a lot more energy, both in terms of total power output and time on grid. And the investments that we're making are showing great results. We've generated more power in the last 4 years from our units. Including the, you know, OPG seeing similar results. They had a unit there, their unit one at Darlington set a world record with over 1,000 days of continuous operation. And then here at Bruce, our unit one set a site record with almost 800 days of continuous operation. That means it just sits there for 800 days and continues to pump up power. It's not dependent on any external events to be able to provide power. So that's safe, reliable, continuous source of grid that can be counted on each and every day is there. And I just think we're really bullish on being able to replace the output of Pickering, at least to a degree, with the actions we have here going on at the site. And then we're also partnering with OPG and looking at new technologies. In fact, we created the Nuclear Innovation Institute here locally, where Cameco and Bruce Power founded the Next Generation of Nuclear Energy, where we're looking at small modular reactors, micro reactors, and even fusion power with general fusion. And that whole realm is quite exciting, quite interesting. OPG is leading the effort there with the siting of an SMR at their Darlington station. So they're renewing that. We've been working hand in hand with them, participating in a technology selection process, and we're looking to see how we can partner with them to take it forward. And at the same time, SAS Power is participating in this as well under the same MOU, and they'll look to potentially build 3 or 4 units in Saskatchewan once the unit at OPG is developed and put forward. And that's how our industry generally works. Like, it'll tie our suppliers in, it'll tie the companies in, we'll all work together, we'll collaborate, and we'll make sure we have a success, just as we've done with the refurbishments. You know, OPG finished their first refurbishment on time and on schedule on time and on budget. And, you know, we've been collaborating with them consistently across that. And we're well on our way here with our major component replacements.
You know, it is the title of the podcast is We Can Do It. I thought that would be a nice little play on words. You know, and obviously CANDU is a really kind of proud Canadian engineering accomplishment. I think it was called certainly one of the top 10 of the 20th century. You know, and I think people sort of think it's a technology that's frozen in time or old, but obviously each of the sites, you know, there were changes that were made and updates that were made. Do you think that there's a role for more CANDU builds? I mean, certainly SMRs have their place in certain jurisdictions, and the micromodular stuff's very promising for the north. But we have a lot of you know, carbon-intensive electricity to replace across this country, and you know, the scale of that's just really huge. I you know, you're from America, so I thought this was kind of interesting. I was talking with a friend of mine, and he was saying, you know, something that's very unique about Canada, and I guess, you know, maybe not unique in terms of other localities where there's been a lot of state involvement in nuclear, is that we do these, you know, multi-unit builds on a single site, and that there's a huge efficiency to that, you know, and that's again why Bruce is so big. You guys have 8 large CANDU units there. You know, nuclear is, I think, kind of in a moment where there's a lot of struggle, especially in the we're talking about this in the context of Earth Day, you know, where people, I think, are starting to see the light on nuclear. But what do you think the prospects are for more CANDU, or just, you know, another large site like we've had in the past here? I know it's challenging, I think, with the kind of present economic models, but just wanted to get your take on that.
Yeah, you know, I think as you look at that, you're going to see different areas of the world do different things depending on the size of their need. Here in Canada, we're blessed with a lot of hydropower. And also our population density has to be taken into consideration. Ontario is a prime example of a perfect application for large units because we have such a population density there. So I think, you know, I think potentially the CANDU reactors, the small modular reactors and micro reactors are going to have a role in a clean energy future, not only here in Canada, but around the world. And I think others will look towards that. In fact, you know, Romania is looking right now at the refurbishment of their units and the possible extension of additional units at their site. And those are CANDU reactors. So I wouldn't rule any of it out in the long term as we pursue CO2-free emissions. You know, I just read a report today from the IAEA, and they're saying that, you know, CO2 emissions are actually going to rise now as the pandemic is loosening up in places and people are getting back to work. And predominantly, the power source that is going to be expanded the most is coal generation. Yeah. You know, yeah. So for all the expansion of renewables around the world, it isn't going to offset what the expansion of coal generation is going to be. And I think in that space is where nuclear fits in well. And you're seeing many countries enter that space and look in terms of looking at projects. The UAE is an example. The United Arab Emirates just put 2 nuclear units online for the first time ever, and they've got 2 more under construction that'll be coming online likely within the next coming year. So you're seeing new entrants into the field, and what's driving them there is the need for clean energy.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about some of the challenges of nuclear. One of those is the waste issue. I know there's plans for a deep geologic repository, and, you know, looking to get community permission in I think Ignace and in South Bruce. You know, I've been told that, you know, you've speak to this issue often, and I'd like to kind of hear your take on your perspectives on the waste issue.
Yeah, let's talk about that. You know, it's been used by the anti-nuclear movement as a way to drive fear about nuclear power. But when you think about it, it's one of the only industries that really captures and contains its products. We don't have emissions. We don't send it out to the environment, right? So we capture it, we contain it, and we hold it in canisters. We have about 50 years of waste right now in canisters that are sitting in an area about the size of a football field. What other industry can make that statement? You know, I often, when you think about clean energies, we talked a little bit about solar panels. Like, these solar panels last about 20, 25 years. Like, where are they going to go afterwards? What landfill are they going in? Or worse, are they going to end up like plastic where they're going to be floating around our waterways, right? Folks are going to dispose of them. There's no recycling program or anything to capture them at any scale like that. And then the same thing with wind units. You know, what happens with those components? They're going and getting buried in landfills. So, you know, when I look at the waste issue, I think it's both for renewables and nuclear, it's a much better position than fossil fuels, where the emissions simply go into the air and they're not accounted for. Other industries like the plastic industries, even automotive, like what happens with those wastes? Where do they end up at the end of the day, right? They're not controlled. The emissions aren't controlled. So I think we've got a pretty good story on that once we get past the fear. So first, it can be stored safely and has been for many, many decades and can continue to be stored for many, many decades safely. There's some areas around the world that have looked at geological repositories as a way of containing it for the long term. Finland has one. Sweden has announced one. Others have them. You also can look then at recycling. France has been recycling fuel for decades, and they've recycled it for Japan, Germany, and UK over the years. Other countries have looked at building recycling centers. In fact, the United States used to recycle fuel before the SALT agreements, the nuclear agreements with Russia, where Jimmy Carter agreed to take the recycling plants out of service. There was one in New York and one in Illinois at the time. So it can be recycled. And when you look at now the newer technologies as it relates to the small modular reactors, you see Bill Gates' TerraPower with a traveling wave reactor that uses spent fuel. And then you also can see Moltex here in Canada that's working with New Brunswick Power with an application that can also use spent fuel. So there are plenty of options. There are really not technical issues to be had. It's more of policy issues in terms of what would be acceptable to governments and how governments want to handle. And I think it's going, you know, in the end, it's going to come down to making smart choices around the environment versus fear. And I think a lot of times that fear component gets amped up. And quite frankly, it's not based on facts. And a lot of these things are just rhetoric that have been repeated so often over the years that people somehow think they're real. And I think some of the movies that you're referring to, and there's one called Pandora's Promise as well that came out some years ago that start to poke holes in the myth, as I'll say it.
I think one of the more interesting facts that I found when I was looking into the waste or the spent fuel issue was, you know, beyond all of the engineering it almost seems like an overcompensation. And, you know, I've talked with some people that talk about some of the sort of theatrics that, you know, happen at waste storage sites and even at nuclear plants where, you know, there's such a desire to prove to the public, you know, that this is, you know, so safe that, you know, we put on these booties, you know, to deal with doses that are almost less than the natural background radiation, or we engineer these waste sites to the nth degree. But, you know, one of the facts that really surprised me was, you know, I think it's the rock at one of the proposed sites. You know, even if all of these engineered barriers were to be violated and, you know, water was to dissolve these fuel pellets, it takes, 3 million years for that water to move 1 meter, and the radioisotopes bind all the rock and clay around them. So, I mean, it's, I think the anti-nuclear folks have sold this vision of, you know, deep geologic repository, that this waste is going to, you know, come up through the earth like a volcano and contaminate, you know, the waterways and the biosphere. And it's just, when you look at the science of it, there's no mechanism for that. You know, it doesn't make any sense. And I mean, that was a, you know, kind of a revelation to me, just in terms of the geologic containment. But I mean, how do you feel? What's the best strategy to sort of communicate that to the public? Because, you know, we're up against, like you said, you repeat the same thing over and over again enough times, and it sticks in people's minds.
Yeah, I think it comes with people like yourself who aren't tied to the industry, exposing these things and talking about it from another perspective and direction, and really broadening that. I think for so many years the industry has just talked to itself, and at one point it was afraid to talk because of rate cases, because of public perception, and I think it did an injustice. Like in the 70s and 80s and 90s. And it really got behind the curve on informing the public. But, you know, I have hope that the younger people especially have an interest in clean energy. You know, a lot of the young people that we're hiring consider themselves environmentalists. They're coming here because they will know that nuclear energy is good for the environment, and they feel good about what they do every day. In fact, you know, I keep this on my desk as a reminder, like this little cube, I don't know if you can see it or not, but if you used all the energy that you use for a year from nuclear energy, this would be the amount of waste that you as an individual produce. So what else do you do in your lifetime that you can make that statement? Think about that, right? The plastic that comes through your home every day, right? The gasoline that goes in your car, the tires that you change on your car, right? The pieces and parts that come off of it, right? I think it's a very much a misrepresented story in that space. So I look forward to being able to continue to talk about this as an industry, and you know, and have people like yourself begin to speak about what you've done the research on and you understand. And I think like in places like Finland, where the facts were exposed, people took the time to understand. You're seeing a small country like Finland move more and more towards nuclear as a clean energy source, including building a repository. And you're seeing the same type of momentum in Sweden and other places.
So I guess just in closing, you know, I think Bruce has been talking about a kind of a net zero target. You know, to me, this seemed a little bit, I know it's kind of all the rage amongst a whole variety of kind of corporate entities. And, you know, the fact that you're already putting 30% of Ontario's power on the grid with, you know, while producing zero emissions seems pretty damn good. But I know the nuclear industry likes to try and go above and beyond. So tell me a little bit about this effort. What's involved, what your intentions are here.
You know, leadership is about actions. Like we were just talking about, you can drum up rhetoric, but at the end of the day, it doesn't accomplish anything. You look at the world, we're struggling with CO2 emissions, and yet we work to block one of the cleanest sources of energies there. So we're making a statement with that. We can be emissions free, and we're going to work on that. We'll be, I think we're the first public utility to announce that we're going to be emissions free by 2027. And we'll do that through offsets by the creation of a carbon offset co-op here locally, but to get the agricultural industry involved with us, but also through innovation in terms of how we upgrade our reactors and how we produce more power here at the site. So I think we can do it, and by leadership by taking action. So we're going to take the action to be set the first example of, yes, this can be done. We can do it. Right. So. It can be done, and we're gonna prove that it can be done.
I mean, it almost seems like people should be buying offsets from you guys in a sense, but that's maybe another story. I think this is probably a good place to leave it, Mike. It's been a lot of fun chatting with you. Like I said, electricity's precarious at my hospital right now, and they've asked me to come in early, so I think we'll wrap it up there. But again, pleasure having you on. Thanks for sharing your perspectives.
And thank you. And thank you for you and your colleagues for all the work that you're doing through this pandemic. You know, we wouldn't be in the situation we are getting through this without the medical community and the frontline workers. So one, I just want to say thank you for doing everything you do each day, and then taking the time to do sessions like this to help inform the public and educate the public. It's just fantastic. And, you know, by working together and collaborating, we'll have a bright future here in Canada and really get past a lot of the near term issues that we face in terms of the pandemic and clean energy.
Yeah, well, I mean, as we say, we're all in this together. And I mean, in terms of my motivations, it's, you know, I see the patient in front of me, but like we were talking about in Hamilton with that economic collapse, you think about the social determinants and environmental determinants of health. So, you know, I mean, sometimes people are a bit puzzled, like, why is a doctor so interested in climate and energy? You know, but that's the motivation. And, you know, when I think about the fact that medical isotopes are just fundamental to modern healthcare. And, you know, I have this saying that I like my climate cool, my air clean, and my surgical instruments sterile. I mean, I think we are all in this together. And I think, you know, that the more I've learned, the more I see that, you know, that what I do is kind of dependent on what you guys do. So I hope that y'all get vaccinated very soon. We're all frontline workers here. So looking forward to releasing this and hearing some discussion about it. We'll be in touch.
Thanks, Dr. Keefer. Have a good evening, and I wish you the best.
Bye for now.
We can do it. We can do it. This is not the time to shirk. We can do it.
Thank you so much for joining us on the We Can Do It podcast. Be sure to like, review, and subscribe.